So we had talked about about this result concerning topospheretic way for building Galois type equivalences. Okay, so this result provides an equivalence between two toposes presented in different ways. The first is a topos of sheaves on an atomic site, and the second is a topos of continuous actions of a topological group, a topological automorphism group of a certain object U in the incompletion of C. So continuous actions on discrete sets. Okay, so what is the interest of this result? The original problem we had was to find new examples of categories whose opposite was equivalent to the category of non-empty transitive continuous actions of a topological automorphism group. So, you see, it is a problem lying at the level of sites. But we decided, we found it convenient to approach it from the extended point of view of toposes. This turns out to be a good choice because, given an equivalence of toposes, one can always wonder whether this equivalence actually restricts to an equivalence of sites. And depending on the situations, this can be or not the case. Now, if we wonder about that in the context of this Galois-type equivalence, we immediately understand that there is no guarantee that such an equivalence will restrict to an equivalence between the opposite of C and the category that you see on the right-hand side of the bridge, the category of non-empty transitive actions of the topological automorphism group. In fact, one can give necessary and sufficient conditions for this to hold. And so if these conditions are not satisfied, one will still have the equivalence at the topospheretic level in spite of the lack of a concrete equivalence at the site level. So this is an illustration of the fact that there are many relations in mathematics that are not necessarily concrete, and in the sense that you cannot understand them at the site level, or at least they are not naturally described by remaining at the level of the sites, but which are well understood when we pass to the setting of toposes. So basically, the idea to restrict to sites is simply that you see the category of transitive non-empty actions that you find on the right-hand side can be characterized in invariant terms starting from the wall topos of continuous actions. In fact, the objects of this full subcategory are precisely the atoms of the topos. What is an atom is just an object which is non-zero and which doesn't have any proper subobjects. So you immediately understand that when you have a topological group, then the atoms of the topos of continuous actions on sets of this topological group are just the transitive non-empty actions. Okay, so we are able to identify the objects of that site in invariant terms from the topos. And then, since this is an invariant, we can look at the other representation. And we can wonder whether there is something from the site that will correspond to an atom of the topos. This is not necessarily the case. So first, the first question one might ask is whether there is an embedding of C-op in the corresponding topos. Because in the case of classical Galois theory, we had an equivalence of categories, so in particular it was we had a full embedding. But in fact, we understand that this is the case if and only if the functor f, given in the previous slide, the functor f is full and faithful, if and only if a certain condition is satisfied. This condition can be made completely explicit, is the condition for every arrow of C to be a strict monomorphism. So there could be categories that satisfy that or not. Only if that is satisfied, we have a full embedding. Now, even under those hypotheses, it might be that not all the atoms of the topos come from the site. What you can say is that when you have an atom of this topos here, since the objects coming from the site form a separating family for the topos, what you can say is that if you have an atom A, there will be an epimorphism from an object coming from the site to A. So there will be necessarily an epimorphism because A is an atom. Okay? And now, by the exactness properties of Grothendieck toposes, this means that we can write A as the quotient of L of C by an equivalence relation internally to the topos. So you see, there is no guarantee whether the category C will be atomically complete in the sense that it will contain objects that realize these quotients. Okay? So it is possible to write down completely concrete conditions for a category to be atomically complete. I don't have the time to give the details, but I just wanted to stress the fact that in practice there are natural examples which satisfy the first condition, the strict monomorphism condition, but not the second. And in those situations, it is natural to... Well, let's just keep here for a second. In that situation, it is natural to wonder what we can add to our category C in order to get a full Galois-type equivalence holding at the level of sites. And in fact, it is also possible, thanks to these topospheoretic techniques, to understand precisely what must be added. We shall call them imaginaries, because in fact, these are really quotients of definable you see, objects by internal equivalence relations. So we can get, yes, please.
What was the functor F?
Where did it go? The functor F is the one which sends every object of C to the set of arrows in the completion from C to U. So it's just the analog of what happens in classical Galois theory. Okay, so we have that, and basically now a few remarks about this theory. Well, actually, these objects you might wonder how can you find them. In fact, they can be found in many fields of mathematics. In fact, one main source for this kind of objects is provided by Frese's construction in model theory and its categorical generalizations. And in fact, we already start seeing the link between Frese and Galois. But I will say more about that in a few minutes. So this is just to say that these objects U, which are C universal and C ultrahomogeneous, often exist. And also, I would like to remark that this result generalizes Grothendieck's theory of Galois categories, which in fact corresponds to the particular case when the fundamental group is pro-discrete. Here we don't pose any restrictions on the topological group. It works for any. And a main difference between Grothendieck's approach and our approach is that Grothendieck worked just at the level of the Galois categories with the fiber functors defined on them. So it was a one-level analysis, while here we make a two-level analysis by using sites that are smaller than the pre-toposes used by Groth and Dick. And this allows us to have properties at the site level that are much easier, that admit simpler formulation than the ones used by Groth and Dick. You see, the key properties for us were amalgamation property, joint embedding property, that are easier than the ones that you would have on bigger sites. So you see, this illustrates the point that I was making, the general point I was making about the fact that working with small sites has advantages in terms of expression of invariance at that level, because if the site is small, also that invariant will admit a formulation that could be much more tractable from a technical point of view. And so we see this to be the case in this setting. So there are many examples of new Galois type theories that can be obtained in this way. So for instance, you get a Galois theory for finite groups, for finite Boolean algebras, for finite graphs. So these are all examples that don't fit with the Galois categories formalism. But in fact, they satisfy all the hypotheses of our theorem except the atomic completion. So in those cases, one has to add these imaginary elements, as I was mentioning. And well, these imaginary elements that have to be added can be described explicitly. In my original paper, I gave one description. And in a forthcoming paper with Laurent Laforgue, we will give a more combinatorial description of these objects. But I mean, what I would like to stress here is that all of this is very, very concrete. But if you think about these connections and also this idea of the imaginaries and what you have to add starting from a category that can be embedded in, can be dually embedded in the category of continuous actions of a topological automorphism groups, what you have to add in order to make these Galois type categories, you see, without the topos theoretic viewpoint, you would be quite lost, right? While, yes, please.
I just want to make an extra comment about what you just explained. So this is, you know it very well, but this is for the people who listen to the talk. If you think, for instance, of the case of the what you call the imaginary finite sets or imaginary finite groups or imaginary finite graphs, in fact, you can apply the construction to many categories. So the category of groups or its opposite, or if you consider a group or a graph, you can consider the category of embeddings of this group in other groups, mm-hmm. or the category of surjections of epimorphic homomorphism mm-hmm. from other groups to this group, and the same for graphs, for instance.
Yeah.
And every time it is possible to complete this category in such a way to make the category Galois.
Yeah.
And the new category you get is classified by another group. Mm. So this means that if, for instance, you consider a finite group or a finite graph, you can associate to it two groups.
Yeah.
One group which classifies the embeddings of this group in other groups and their imaginary completions.
Yeah.
And another group which classifies the fibrations over your group and their imaginary completions. And a very yeah. puzzling question for us yeah. is whether there is a relationship between these two groups. So this is one of the questions.
We will address.
Yes, exactly.
Okay, so let's go on. So so I mentioned that this theorem on Galois theory I proved it using logical tools. So, and in fact, it is precisely this logical interpretation which makes it clear the link between that and phrase-based construction. So now I'm going to say a few words about that. In fact, this approach also has suggested a way of understanding the phenomenon of independence from L, of L-adic cohomology. So this is a project in progress. I mean, to try to possibly understand different L-adic cohomologies as points, as different points of one motivic topos with the good properties that we expect to be shared by all these cohomological theories. Anyway, in order to describe this point of view, this logical point of view, I have to introduce the concept of a theory of pre-shift type, because this will provide us the setting for formulating our generalization of Frege theorem, which, as you will quickly recognize, is intimately related to our treatment of Galois theory. Okay, so theories of pre-shift type. What is a theory of pre-shift type? It is a theory classified by a pre-shift topos, by definition. So how can we think about a theory of pre-shift type? Well, in some sense, since every Grothendieck topos is a subtopos of a topos of pre-shifts, and given the duality between quotients and subtoposes that I mentioned earlier, we can really think of theories of pre-shift type as a sort of building blocks from which we can construct all other geometric theories just by adding more axioms over their signature. But the point that I would like to stress now, and which explains how it was possible to derive that categorical theorem from a logical theorem, is the fact that theories of pre-shift type can be regarded as the logical counterpart of small categories in the following sense. So if we have a theory of pre-shift type, its categories of set-based models is equivalent to the incompletion of the full subcategory on the finitely presentable ones. Why this? Because suppose that the theory T is classified by a pre-shift topos. So we write like that, C set, and we don't a priori know who C is, okay? So we calculate the points of this topos, and by the equivalence I mentioned earlier, yesterday, we know that the points are the flat functors from C op to set. We know that these are the points, but this is just the incompletion of C. And of course, C embeds here. Now, the thing is that you can recover C from the incompletion up to idempotent splitting completion as the full subcategory on the finitely presentable models. Finitely presentable objects. So in general, if you have a category A with filtered colimits, you have a notion of finite presentability for an object of A. It is this. So you consider this Hom functor with associated with the object A, and you say that A is finitely presentable if this functor preserves filtered colimits. So this notion is, you see, it is a categorical invariant. And it's very interesting because it allows one to recover, as I said, C from the incompletion up to idempotent splitting completion. So basically, the idempotent splitting completion, sometimes it's called the Cauchy completion, is equivalent to the full subcategory on the finitely presentable objects. Yeah, Karubi envelope, there are many terms in the... Yeah, so it is a yeah, for sure. This is the least we can say. Well, anyway, so you see, if we regard this topos as the classifying topos for T, then the points are just the models of T in set. So C can be identified up to Cauchy completion with the category of finitely presentable models of the theory. So this means that that we can always represent the classifying topos of a theory of preshift type in this form, like the category of functors from the category of finitely presentable models with values in sets. This concerning the first point, but we can do the converse. I mean, if we start with any category C, then you see we have this topos, and I mentioned yesterday that any topos can be seen as the classifying topos of something. And so I can take a theory T, which will be, for instance, the theory of flat functors on COP, and this will be a theory of preshift type classified by that topos. And so, up to Cauchy completion, C will be equivalent to the category of finitely presentable models of that theory of preshift type. So you see, this gives a link between category theory and logic. And so, basically, it means that if we want, we can think in a logical way about whatever category. This is quite powerful because this is what I used actually to make the translation from the logical statement concerning Galois, which was much easier to prove, to the general categorical statement. Okay, so just a remark, any geometric theory T can be expanded. By expanded, I mean that you can just add sorts, function symbols, relation symbols, and axioms to its signature to get another theory, which will be classified by that topos. In fact, as a general remark, this is well treated in my book, if you are interested in that. When you have an expansion of a geometric theory, so you know that T and T prime is an expansion of T, then basically you, at the level of sites, you have that you can send the syntactic site of T into the syntactic site of, J, of T prime, and so this will be a morphism of sites, and it will induce a morphism of the two classifying topos in that direction. So you see, when you have an expansion, it corresponds to a geometric morphism between the classifying topos. A converse is also true in the sense that if you start with a classifying topos and you have a geometric morphism to it from a certain topos E, then you can find a geometric expansion of T such that this will be equivalent to classifying topos of T prime, and we will have a commutative triangle of this kind. So you can apply that to the canonical geometric morphism that you have always from that to the classifying topos of the theory, and in this way, you know, there are concrete techniques that are described in the book to fabricate actually these theories of preshift type. There is not one canonical way you can do it, there are many ways, but there are general methods that can be used for doing that. Okay, now let's go on. Now here are just a list of examples of theories of pre-shift type. I would like just to remark that every finitary algebraic theory is of pre-shift type. More generally, any so-called Cartesian theory is of pre-shift type. But this class is, as you can imagine, very wide. After all, you see all categories or small categories fit in this framework. So you can expect many different looking theories to be of pre-shift type. Here is a list of theories that are not finitary algebraic, but which are classified by a pre-shift topos. In fact, it is quite subtle to characterize the class of theories classified by a pre-shift topos. Apparently, you would think that it is easy because we are talking about the simplest kind of toposes. Pre-shift toposes, after all, I mean, you don't have a Grothendieck topology in the site. But in fact, it is quite subtle, so a great part of my book is devoted to a systematic study of this subject to understand the behavior, the model theory of these theories, and generate new examples of such theories. I have already mentioned, for instance, in the context of NV algebras, in fact, there are surprisingly many theories of pre-shift type. They also naturally arise in the context of Cohn and Constani's program. There is a paper which I co-authored with a former student of mine, Nicolas Wenzlaff, about cyclic theories. So we describe some theories that are classified by the toposes that are involved in Cohn and Constani's program. So you see, these are all quite interesting theories, despite the fact that they are classified by relatively simple toposes. Now, I would like to remark in relation with the bridge technique that by their very definition, theories of pre-shift type provide us with a perfect opportunity to test the bridge philosophy because, you see, we have remarked that their classifying topos can always be represented in this semantic way, just functors on the category of finitely presentable models with values in sets on one end. But of course, we always have the syntactic representation of the, yes, please.
Constructively, there are many notions of finiteness. What do you mean with the geometric theory of finite sets?
Yeah, it is a geometric theory which was introduced by Johnston, whose set-based models can be identified with finite sets, but the model homomorphisms are surjective maps between. Yeah, I mean, it's a bit weird theory.
What kind of finite, like?
No, finite in the sense of cardinality.
In a constructive. Yeah, it could be Kuratovsky finite or some other. Yeah.
Okay, anyway, here, what I was saying is that we dispose of two different representations for the classifying topos of a theory of pre-shift type. And so you see, this side is semantic, that other side is syntactic. And so we can look at some invariants from the points of view of the two sides. And so, for instance, it becomes quite interesting to investigate the relationship between the notion of the categorical notion of finite presentability that we have introduced and the syntactic notion of finite presentability of a model as extrapolated from universal algebra. You see, in universal algebra, you have a notion of a model presented by generators and relations, or more generally, just presented by a geometric formula. And so you say that a model is presented by such a formula, and you write like that, and this is the classical notation, if it satisfies the universal property that the T-model homomorphisms from this to any other set-based model are in natural bijection with the elements of the interpretation of the formula in the model N. So you see, this is the syntactic notion of finite presentability. So the model is finitely presented if there exists a geometric formula presenting it in that sense. So in universal algebra, it is a well-known result that the two notions coincide. I mean, finite presentability in the syntactic sense is equivalent to finite presentability in the semantic sense. It is therefore natural to wonder whether this is also true for theories of pre-shift type. And the proof that this holds, and also the characterization of the formulas which present those models, is provided by this result, which is actually a bridge. We look at this invariant, the notion of an irreducible object of a topos. So an object of a topos is said to be irreducible if every epimorphic family of arrows going to that object contains a split epimorphism. If you look at that invariant from the two sides, basically, by the fact that this category of finitely presentable models is quasi-complete, you catch exactly the object coming from the site on the left. And on the right, you catch formulas of a specific kind, the so-called irreducible formulas, the ones that, regarded as objects of the syntactic category, don't admit any non-trivial covering sieve. Okay, so you see, this is an example of a result, again, that I wouldn't imagine one could prove, at least at this level of generality, without passing through a bridge. Because you see that the key point is really this topological notion of irreducibility, which allows us to make the comparison. And this result, for me, was quite motivating when I obtained that, because you see, when you approach the problem from a concrete point of view, you might really feel lost, because suppose that you start with a model that is finitely presentable in the semantic sense, then you would look for a formula which presents that model, and you don't know where to find this formula. You really have to think abstractly, and if you do, if you work at the level of the topos will, you see, contain all the things built from the formulas, and you will recognize that there will actually be something coming from the syntactic site just by the fact that the object is irreducible, and that will correspond to your finitely presentable model. So you see, this is an illustration of the power of abstract thinking, if you want, because you see, I remember when I thought for the first time about this problem, my reaction was, I really want to fabricate this this formula, but I just didn't know how to do, because even in concrete cases, it's not something that it's easy to imagine, and this result holds at a very high level of generality. So it is by no means straightforward, but look, it was very easy to obtain. I mean, the proof is just, in a sense, it is very mechanical. I mean, once you have found the right invariant, it's just a matter of computing it on the two sides, and you get that. Okay, so another quite surprising result that can be obtained, again, using the bridge technique, is this definability theorem, which applies to all theories of pre-shift type, and which was not even known in the particular setting of finitary algebraic theories. So this result basically says that any property of tuples of finitely presentable models of a theory of pre-shift type, which is functorial, is definable by a geometric formula in the language of the theory among all the finitely presentable models. So suppose, for instance, you are in the theory of rings, which is of pre-shift type, and you have a property of elements of rings that is preserved by all ring homomorphisms. How would you imagine being able to find a geometric formula defining that? I mean, no clue, at least for me, and also for other people I asked too. But again, Topos theory gives a straight answer to that. Because, again, we just change our invariant. This time, instead of considering the invariant notion of an irreducible object, we consider the notion of subobject of the universal model of the theory. So the sorts that appear there are just the ones specified by the context. Okay? So we have this invariant, and we calculate it from the two different points of view. So from the point of view of the semantic side, well, basically the universal model of the theory inside that topos, it's like that. So let's call it n of t, So n of t is defined in this way. It assigns to each sort over the language of the theory the functor which just takes the value of the model at the sort. So it's just, it assigns, p to, it assigns p of a to any p, okay? It's like that, and it is also defined naturally on the function symbols and relation symbols. And so this is the universal model, and you can easily realize about that. But on the other side, the universal model is just the image of the model M of T inside the syntactic category, the one that we introduced yesterday, under the Yonida embedding. I just apply the Yonida embedding to that, and this is the universal model there. So as you can see, you have to recall how this model was defined. It was the tautological model, so it was completely syntactic. Everything was made up of formulas. Now, look at the subobjects on both sides. On that side, you immediately realize that the subobjects are just the functorial assignments. So the properties that are stable under, because I am taking subobjects in a topos of functors. So the subobjects are subfunctors. So these are the functorial properties. But on the other hand, the subobjects are just formulas. And so from that, you obtain that. And again, this is a result that even in particular cases, I wouldn't be able to prove, using more concrete methods. And again, you see there is nothing particularly difficult about that when you approach it topos theoretically, because again, you see I'm always using very simple invariants, nothing difficult. But you see, this suggests the fact that imagine if you use more complicated invariants, you will get much more striking bridges that really would be even harder to imagine from a concrete point of view. Okay, I would like just to briefly mention that there are some characterization theorems for theories of pre-shift type. Yes, please.
So the previous theorem is wrong for non-pre-shift type?
No. No, even in particular cases, as far as I know,
it's unknown.
Yes.
And what is exactly the formula that you obtain for this?
Well, depending on the cases, you might get a more or less concrete description, but in general, you don't have. It depends on the representations for the toposes that you have. So the result is it is an invariant, and so you can calculate, but again, in general, you cannot be more explicit than that. In particular cases, you might try, maybe by using other sites, to identify these formulas. But, Okay, so characterization theorems, well, there are many results that one can prove for characterizing these theorems of different nature. So one can have a syntactic characterization, which is the following. So a geometric theory is of pre-shift type if every geometric formula, when regarded as an object of the syntactic category, can be covered by irreducible formulas. So it's quite intuitive as a criterion, but it can be quite useful when you have the syntax of the theory available. It can help you to understand whether it is of pre-shift type or not. That other result is different. It refers to the theorems we have proved about finite presentability and definability. Basically, it shows that these properties are quite characterizing of this class of theories. I mean, to have such a strong definability theorem is something that will not hold for many other theories that are not of pre-shift type. This is basically what the theorem is telling you. Then there is also a more sophisticated characterization theorem, which involves the consideration of models of the theory in arbitrary growth and decomposes, and which gives semantic conditions, necessary and sufficient semantic conditions for a theory to be of pre-shift type. But all of this you can find in my book if you want to know more about. Okay, now I would like to talk about quotients of theories of pre-shift type, because I said that theories of pre-shift type can be seen as the building blocks, and then all other theories can be obtained starting from them just by adding axioms. So you see, if you consider the notion of a subtopos in the context of the representation of a certain classifying topos as a topos of sheaves on a site, you immediately obtain a correspondence, between the quotients of the theory and the growth and dic topologies on the category C, which refine the growth and dic topology J. Okay, so this correspondence, which of course the right arch of the bridge is given by the duality theorem there, and the left arch is a classical result that was mentioned in Laurent Laforgue's course. So you see, we have a bridge by putting together the two arches. From this, we deduce that there is a bijection, an order-preserving bijection between the quotients and the growth and dic topologies. And such a result can be useful in a variety of contexts. In particular, you can apply it to the syntactic side of definition of the classifying topos of the theory, or you can apply it in the context of a theory of pre-shift type. And in both cases, you obtain a correspondence between quotients and growth and dic topologies. These are quite interesting correspondences from a proof theoretic viewpoint, because they allow you to study the proof theory of geometric theories in a completely different way, by using considerations of sieves on categories and the growth and dic topologies generated by families of sieves, and so on. So basically, there are proof theoretic equivalences which actually derive from the expression of the subtopos invariant in terms of the two sides. They are really arising from that. Proof theoretic equivalences between the classical proof system of geometric logic over a given theory T, and new proof systems for sieves rather than for sequence, whose inference rule correspond to the axioms of growth and dic topologies. And these equivalences are useful because, in fact, they allow one to study provability of a certain sequence by checking whether a family of sieves attached to that sequence belongs to the growth and dic topology generated by a family of sieves. And this is something that one can calculate. Unlike what happens in the classical proof system for geometric logic, that because of its computational complexity, because there are many inference rules rather than just two, you see, it is much more difficult. So in my book there is in particular a formula which allows you to compute this Grothendieck topology generated by a given family of sieves, and using that you can mechanically check, in a sense, whether a certain sieve belongs to a certain topology, and therefore you can, for instance, investigate all sorts of provability questions related to that. Okay, so now let's be more precise.
Olivia, excuse yes. me. Does it mean yeah. that you have an algorithm mm. for determining if a proposition is or is not a consequence of a family of axioms, at least in the setting of geometric logic?
Algorithm is a strong word. Okay. For sure, there is this closed formula.
Yeah.
So one should try to study that yeah. and investigate whether one can make mm. it into an algorithm. Probably not, but yeah. But at least, I mean, I have used that formula, for
to
instance,
prove actual theorems.
To, yeah. Yes, to prove results. And mm. Also, you can use this correspondence between quotients and topologies to make all sorts of calculations on quotients of a geometric theory. You might want to take operations on all the Ising operations that you have at the level of subtoposies. I mean, the co-Ising algebra of subtoposies transforms into Ising algebra structure at the level of quotients. So you have all these Ising operations, and you can compute them. And in general, when you try to do this at the level of quotients, it looks quite hard. Then when you pass to the Grothendieck topologies, again, I have found formulas which allow you to make these calculations in an easier way. So I would like just to mention that it's possible to calculate explicitly this Grothendieck topology associated with a quotient of a given theory of pre-shift type. I don't have the time to go into these details, but you can find this in the book. In fact, this is a generalization of something which was known for Cartesian theories. And in fact, when theories are Cartesian, this correspondence between the Grothendieck topologies and the quotients, at least in the finitary setting, has been very successfully exploited by Coste, Lombardi, and Roy, was in the context of dynamical theories. This is so there is a strict link between the particular case of that for Cartesian theories and that work. Okay, so I'll skip that. Yes, this I have already said, that you can investigate probability by looking at the corresponding sieves and checking whether they belong to the topology. So now I would like just to state this Frese theorem, and you will see immediately the link with Galois, because the same kind of properties arise, amalgamation property and joint embedding property. So the theorem says, if you have a theory of pre-shift type whose category of finitely presentable models is non-empty and satisfies AP and JEP, then we can conclude that the theory T prime, the quotient of T, which axiomatizes the homogeneous models in the sense of that definition, we can conclude that is complete and atomic. And so this is a wide generalization of Frese's theorem in classical model theory, and you see the link with Galois theory. Here, instead of requiring ultra-homogeneity, we have a weaker notion, the notion of homogeneity. In the case of Galois theory, it was universality and ultra-homogeneity, which both together they imply homogeneity. In fact, you understand how this result will arise. In fact, it is a triple bridge. So basically, you consider the same kind of toposes that were used in the context of Galois theory, atomic toposes on one end, But this time, instead of using of looking for group theoretic representations, you represent them syntactically by using the syntactic site of a theory that will be a quotient of the given theory of pre-shift type. And by doing this, you obtain the result. You see that the property of a topos to be atomic is connected on one side to the property of amalgamation property to the amalgamation property on the category of finitely presentable models of the theory. So you see, when you have amalgamation property on a category, then you can always put the atomic topology on the opposite of it, and then you know by a general result that the corresponding topos is atomic. But then when you try to understand what this invariant means in terms of the other site, you get the syntactic property of atomicity, which is something completely different, but it is something known in the context of model theory. So it means that every formula in the language of the theory can be provably decomposed as a disjunction of formulas which behave like atoms with respect to provability. Okay, and then you see the first bridge. The second bridge is based on the invariant notion of being two-valued. And you see joint embedding to correspond precisely to completeness of the theory T prime. And the third invariant, just the notion of point of the topos, you get that the points of the atomic topos correspond exactly to the homogeneous models of T. So you see, this is interesting because this notion of homogeneity was introduced by Frassé without having any topos theory in mind, but in fact it arises naturally from the calculation of points of an atomic topos. And so you see, by just putting together these three bridges, this is how you get that result. And of course, you see, nobody prevents us from considering other invariants, and you can imagine that by considering many other invariants, you will generate all sorts of results surrounding this theme, and which will enrich our understanding of the Frassé phenomenon. Okay, now my time is almost over, so I would like just to briefly mention that stone-type dualities can be very well understood also by using topos theoretic bridges. In fact, they can be all recovered from a single representation result in topos theory, which is Grothendieck's comparison lemma. So basically, starting from that result, you can develop a theory which allows you to generate many stone-type dualities between pre-ordered structures and posets, locales and topological spaces. So basically, I just cite the two simplest examples. So in the case of stone duality, you have Boolean algebra, and you regard it as a poset category, and you put the coherent topology on that, and this is equivalent to the topos of sheaves on the stone space. And then by functorializing this, you get a stone duality. Take Lindemann-Tarski duality. If you take A, an atomic complete Boolean algebra, then the subcategory of atoms of this is dense, which means that the topos of sheaves on A, regarded as a locale, so with the canonical topology, is equivalent to the pre-sheaf topos on the category of atoms. And again, by functorializing this, by considering geometric morphisms of toposes as an invariant, you get that duality. So these are, of course, very classical cases, but you can use the methodology to generate many new dualities. So if you want to know more about that, the paper is called A Topos Theoretic Approach to Stone-Type Dualities. Okay, I have already talked about NV algebras, so I just would like to mention as a conclusion some future perspectives. I would like to emphasize that these results are just nothing, I mean, compared to what will come next. I mean, if more people work on topos theory, in particular on this duality, this very rich duality between sites or presentations and topologies and invariants. So I think that all of this really proves that topologies have a creative power in mathematics. Of course, there is a lot to do, both at the theoretical and at the applied level, in order to make topos theory as an essential tool in the study of mathematical theories and their relations. So here I have just listed some of the topics I would like to develop or to see developed in the future. So as you can see, work is not missing. Okay, so you are of course very encouraged to contribute to this program. I really think that we are at the beginning of really even a new subject, if you want, a new way of exploring mathematics using topologies, even though, of course, topologies have already been applied in very striking ways till now, but I think that the potential of this notion really is very far from being exhausted. Okay, so just a few references. Well, there is my book I already mentioned too many times during the course, but maybe just as an introduction to before having to look at the book, this memoir d'habilitation, disabilitation thesis contains an overview of selection of bridges in different areas, so it could be maybe a preliminary reading. Okay, so I'll stop now. Thank you very much. Thanks, too kind.
No, so I would want to make a comment just to go even further in your in the direction you said. So in everything you have explained, you have drawn bridges, and as you explained to me many times, in bridges there are two parts. There is the deck of the bridge, which is the Morita equivalence, and there are the arch of the bridge, which are the site characterization of some invariant. And a very striking feature in the different examples you gave is that even very simple Morita equivalences, almost obvious Morita equivalences, give rise to very striking results. So in fact, this means that in this bridge technique, the Morita equivalence part is easier than the site characterization part.
The
examples you gave, so there were, except possibly for the Galois equivalence, which is
depends.
So there was this part which, for most examples, was very elementary, in fact, almost tautological.
Yeah.
And then you choose some invariants, and the examples you gave are simple invariants,
yeah.
And you compute site characterization for them, yeah. And already it gives very striking results, and results which most often could not have been predicted without this computation. And so the comment I would make is the following. Yesterday, so I mentioned that this general principle to look for site characterization of topos theoretic invariants is never, as far as I know, stated as such by Grothendieck, yeah. Even though I said Grothendieck is doing that all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And so here I want to mention that in fact the some of the deepest parts of mathematical research in present day mathematics are
arches of
tries
of,
yeah. are, are attempts
to find
site characterization.
Yeah.
What I mean is first the Motivic program. Mm. So what is the Motivic program all about? It is looking for site characterization of some very particular and very deep topostatic invariants, which are cohomological invariants.
Yeah.
You start from an algebraic variety, you attach to, which means you start from a geometric situation. In this geometric situation, you define a top, a site, okay? So, of course, the étale site or the crystalline site, and then you have the associated topos, and then there are the cohomological invariants of this topos.
Yeah.
And the whole Motivic program consists in trying to find site characterizations for these cohomological invariants. Okay, so by now there is an even deeper topostatic invariant, which is the Poincaré or Poincaré Galois or Galois fundamental group. Once again, you start from a scheme. Okay, you have the étale topos. And there is an invariant of this topos, which is the fundamental group. In fact, it is defined for almost all toposes, so in particular for this topos. And then Grothendieck, once again, has proposed a program for finding information about this fundamental group and for relating this topos theoretic invariant to geometry. This is the so-called Abelian geometry program. Okay, and lastly, of course, I would want to relate that to my own initial subject, which is the Langlands program. So the Langlands program is a generalization of class field theory, but once again, it is a site characterization. It can be qualified as a particular case of site characterization. What you do is, once again, you consider a number field or a function field, and you have the associated Galois group, which is a topostatic invariant, and you try to compute it or to compute part of this group, so for instance, the Abelian part of this group. Or, in the case of the Langlands program, you consider linear representations of this group, which means linear objects of the associated topos.
Yes.
And you try to express that in concrete geometric terms. And once again, you see, it is a site characterization problem. So this means that, of course, what I am talking about, these examples are given, I mentioned, are some of the deepest and most difficult problems in present-day mathematics. Whereas what you have presented here, the examples you have given, are with simple invariants.
Yes.
And these simple invariants, together with site characterizations, already give very striking results. But so, the comment I want to make is that this means that this general program of site characterization should be studied in a systematic way.
Yeah.
I mean that, you see, here you have simple examples. In some sense, they are the easiest non-trivial examples, and already you get interesting results, whereas, of course, the program of motifs or the Abelian geometry program or the Langlands program are extremely difficult and deep. But if you want to do mathematics seriously, as Grothendieck did, it is better not to try to go directly to the most difficult results.
Yeah.
You should develop the theory in a systematic way, always beginning with what is simple. You should do the simple things first, and then to develop it systematically.
Yeah,
I wanted to say, just to, so you just said at the end of your talk that this is just the beginning of the story.
Yeah.
And so the point I want to make
is to show you that there is much at stake here, and that this program should be developed in a systematic way. And of course, for doing that, many people are
yes.
needed. And so.
Yeah, okay. Exactly. So you see, there I really brought a systematic study of invariants.
Yeah, systematic.
Systematic. It's very important. You see, in terms of their presentations, because. So far, we are really missing. So it's also hard, you see, at the present moment, the theory is in some sense not yet user-friendly, in the sense that it is it can be hard for a specialist in a certain area of mathematics to identify the topospheretic invariants that could be useful for understanding the concrete questions, just because this systematic study is missing. So for sure, there is a core work to be done. Yeah.